welcome our speaker for this afternoon. We have Dr. Sime,
Sime, it takes practice.
Okay,
yeah, I'm used to it.
Curkovic, right? And he is a professor of management in the Hayward College of Business and Integrated Supply Management Program, which some of you may have heard about. That is an outstanding program, one of the best in the nation. Dr. Curkovic got his bachelor's degree at Clarion University and his doctoral degree at Michigan State University. And one of his expertise is in the area of environmentally responsible manufacturing. Today, he is going to talk to us about why U.S. firms are becoming more socially responsible and sustainable. And thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. I wasn't expecting this many people. It's 60 degrees and sunny outside. And then I saw the sign-in sheet, and I'm like, they have to be here. That's okay. I'm going to try to keep this a little informal. I'm not going to have a presentation up on a screen and go through it side by side, but I've got my presentation on a handout here, and I'd like to just thumb through this as I talk about this material. Sure. That'll be coming around in a second here. Let me begin by saying, 20 years ago, I did a dissertation for my doctorate in business on environmentally responsible manufacturing. I had a lot of faculty and professors come up to me and say, you know, it's kind of a trendy buzzword kind of thing. It's a flash in the pan. This isn't sustainable. Back then, they said it wasn't sustainable, and they used the word sustainable in the context of it wasn't going to go anywhere and move forward as a field, because back then, we didn't actually refer to being greener as being sustainable and sustainability. It wasn't actually a business term quite yet. So I said, no, I'm going to roll the dice and take my chances on this. And I'll be perfectly honest with you. I don't think sustainability, corporate social responsibility, environment and responsible manufacturing, call it whatever you want. I don't think it's a revolution right now in this country. I think a few companies are doing it. I think it's anecdotal. It's isolated. So I would call it a movement, but not a revolution. Quality in the 1980s, that was a revolution. That stuff is as important today as it was in the 1980s. In fact, it's probably more important today. It's held after 3+ decades. Core competencies of the 1990s, that's just as important to businesses today as it was in the 1990s. Around 2000, this thing of mass customization, giving customers exactly what they want with no loss in cost efficiency, I would call all of those things revolutions because they just haven't slowed down. Sustainability, I don't know. I don't know if I'd call it a revolution, but I'd call it a movement because it's still around. It has some momentum, but it's kind of sputtering a little bit. So one of the things I wanted to talk about was why some firms are actually focused on becoming more corporately socially responsible and sustainable. And you'll notice in my title, I don't know if this is proper English, in parentheses I said, or aren't they? And on the spell check, there was no like red line underneath any of that, so I think it's proper English. But the point I'm trying to make is we keep hearing about how corporate America and industry is becoming more corporate socially responsible or more sustainable or greener. And I'm like, are they really, or is that just what we think? Because we hear about Nike, Microsoft, and Kellogg's doing some pretty cool things on the sustainability side, but the majority of companies aren't those companies that I just mentioned. I will throw this out there as well. I teach in an undergraduate program called Supply Chain Management. Basically, industry is obsessed with this major and this degree. What we basically teach our students to do is teach them to do things better, faster, and cheaper when they go out in the workforce. So a job for one of my students might be Ford hires one of my students and says, buy $30 million worth of parts for us and make sure that our car and truck plants have the right parts at the right place at the right time and at the right price. So that would be a job. Half of our students become buyers for large organizations and spend millions of dollars buying stuff on behalf of the companies that they work for. Job placements near perfect, starting salaries are through the roof. We have companies like General Motors hiring 20% of our students and starting our students off at $64K a year, which isn't bad when you're 22 years old. I tell my students, not bad because you're not worth $64K. What 22-year-old is worth $64K a year? But supply and demand conditions are such where the lines intersect at $64K a year. So we keep going to our advisory council, which is made up of companies that recruit from our program. We keep asking them, what do you want from our students to make sure that you always pay a premium for them in this field that you say is very valuable to you? And they come back and say, well, they got to take engineering classes because at work they have to talk to engineers. They have to take law classes because we have to make sure we don't get sued by suppliers and customers. They have to take negotiation classes so they can negotiate the terms and conditions of contracts with suppliers. So they just keep throwing these skill sets they want from our students, and we keep giving our students these skill sets, and their skill sets, even though it's a very niche specialized area, become more strategic in nature, and in return, our students command higher salaries in the marketplace. So we keep going to them, and we say, like, what do you want our students to know and learn in the classroom? So I put on the agenda, how about sustainability? So we talk about this. So I had someone come in that was an expert on sustainability and talk about how companies can implement frameworks for becoming more sustainable, environmentally friendly, and responsible. You could hear crickets chirping in the room. They wanted nothing to do with it. No, you teach our students to do things better, faster, and cheaper, and anything that gets in the way of that isn't helping us. I was shocked because I run the program with, along with a couple of other professors. We put it on the agenda thinking we were proactive. Hey, industry, we know this is a hot topic for you. Tell us what you want from us in terms of teaching our students so that they understand sustainability. They want to move on to things that focused on cost efficiency. How can I outsource to China so that I can do it in a way that reduces my lead times and my freight and my insurance so that instead of paying $1 per part from a supplier in Indiana, it's costing me 30 cents per part in China. That's what they want us to teach them on. Now, I was a little surprised by that. If I mention the names of the companies, and I won't because that'd probably be inappropriate, but you probably drive their cars, you buy their appliances, you eat their food, and you would recognize the names of these companies. Most of them are elitist types, Fortune 500 companies that basically said, this isn't a priority for us. So at these companies, there's leadership saying, we're going to focus on doing things better, faster, and cheaper. And then anything that gets in the way of that, we just don't have time for. And everyone will be rewarded accordingly based on those things. So I was a little surprised and I was shocked because I dedicated a little bit of my life to this topic area. And the companies that I service are basically telling me, you know, it's not a priority for us right now. So to that extent, I don't think it's a revolution. I think it's somewhat of a movement. It's anecdotal, it's isolated, and a few companies are doing it. That's kind of what I like to talk about. If you go to the second slide or page, I want to try to show you why I think companies are trying to become more socially responsible and sustainable. So the first one there is there's government and political pressure. Irresponsibility is difficult to defend politically. Laws are ruthlessly retroactive. This factor increases the attractiveness of prevention as compared to remediation. I would agree. Here's some stats for you. 40% of the world's lawyers are American. Okay? The fifth most powerful lobbying power in America is the trial lawyers of America. America's only 4% of the global population, 40% of the world's lawyers are in America. America has the largest GDP on the planet, about $17 trillion. Largest economy in the world. About 2.4% of our economy is lawsuits and litigation, tort costs. So I don't know if that's good or bad. I think it's good in the sense that companies have to take things a little seriously, otherwise the consequences are enormous. At the same time, I think if you're driving around chasing ambulances all the time and looking for someone to blame for everything that happens wrong in your life, that's probably a bad thing as well. My concern with 2.4% of our $17 trillion economy being tort costs is that's three times the average of other industrialized nations. When you're comparing industrialized nations, I thought you were usually comparing apples to apples and things should be on a level playing field. There's something going on with litigation in our country that's different than in other countries, and I think in response to that, this in itself has kicked a few companies in the butt to say maybe we need to be a little more proactive when it comes to the environment, being greener and being more sustainable. Just the legal consequences of not being are so enormous that they have to respond to that. The other one is introduction of new international standards. A lot of companies do business in America that are owned by non-American parent firms, and they're putting pressure on those companies to do things that they do in their home markets. American companies likewise have operations in different parts of the world where the local communities and governments put pressure on them to do certain things. Some of this pressure is focused on being environmentally responsible, sustainability, social responsibility. So if Whirlpool builds something in Mexico, the Mexican government will put pressure on Whirlpool to get that facility ISO 14000 certified. ISO 14000 is an international environmental standard, and a company has to prove that it has policies and procedures in place to deal with waste and pollution. And the idea is, if you got policies and procedures in place to deal with pollution, you might actually deal with it. There's data that says companies sometimes pollute less because they pursue these international standards. But there's also data that says these standards are incredibly expensive, time-consuming, have a lot of paperwork associated with them. And if companies do it for all the wrong reasons, like someone's making them do it, then they're not especially effective. So right now there are a bunch of international standards that focus on different components of sustainability. ISO 14000 focuses focuses on pollution. SA 8000 focuses on like work conditions, child labor laws, do they work 90 hours a week, are they 13 years old, that sort of thing. ISO 31000 focuses on risk management. There's an ISO standard for energy, there's an ISO standard for privacy, confidentiality, IT issues and security issues. My point there is a lot of companies are doing business all over the world, and sometimes they're becoming more sustainable because there's competitive pressure for them to do so, so they pursue these standards that have something to do with a component of sustainability. My problem with these standards, one is, one focuses on pollution, one focuses on energy, one focuses on child labor. There's literally dozens of international standards that companies can pursue, and chances are they're not saying, let's do all of them. They don't have the time, they don't have the money. So I wouldn't say there's a comprehensive framework that builds it all in together in a way that makes sense and is efficient and gets the job done. What does that mean? It actually makes you more sustainable. Opportunity for publicity. This is a tough one, good versus bad. Can you attach a dollar sign to not having any bad publicity? Can you attach a dollar sign to actually having bad publicity? So it's a qualitative measure that you can't really quantify, but a lot of companies are saying they think the dollar sign is so huge, even though they can't really measure it, that in itself gives them an incentive to be more environmentally responsible. If you go to the next page, I struggle with this one. I could give you pages and pages of data that say you are willing to pay more for products and services that are provided to you in a way that's more sustainable, more environmentally responsible, greener. Are you guys, Allie, are you willing to pay three times as much for something because it uses more recycled material?
Depends.
Actually costs to begin with, like, can I afford to pay three times as much? It depends. Yeah.
I'm not convinced. I'm not paying more. I work hard for my money, and I want value. I want it all. Yes, sir?
There is such a thing as economics.
Yep.
When they intersect, demand and others, it means something.
Yep.
Cannot deny
that. You cannot deny that, and if you deny it, you will fail.
It depends on
not deny
it. Yep.
It depends on if the product's better, too, because, like, grass-fed meat versus, like, stuff-fed, you know, and
right.
A lot is just so much better.
Okay. Let me give you an example of one I deal with. When you go to the store and you buy toilet paper, you can buy toilet paper made from virgin material. And actually, depending on what raw material costs are, quite often virgin material for toilet paper will actually cost you less than toilet paper that's made from recycled paper. Okay? It will cost less, and I've tried both. The virgin material works way better. I'm not messing around with toilet paper. If it's gonna cost me 30% more to buy recycled material and toilet paper and it doesn't work as well, I'm out. So supply and demand conditions aren't going to be favorable. So for the companies that think that there's a market for that, I think it's not going to be favorable for them. At the same time, there's some of that out there. So I'm thinking you two, based on what you said, you might just go with it and pay 30 cents more per roll.
No, I don't do that.
Now you're not so convinced, right? Right. Based on my personal experiences of it, it doesn't work as well.
Yeah.
Yep.
I say, the first thing I heard you say when I sat down is I want it all. And that's an ecosystem. It's about selfishness and it's about me. And if we're gonna have sustainability, it's impossible to have sustainability if we think about cost in an ecosystem. You know, everything has to be thought about in an ecosystem.
I agree.
So if you want to have sustainability and you don't change the way you think and the way you behave, it's impossible.
Right.
So the question begins with each individual. How are people gonna change the way they think and behave and overcome their ego? That's the question of religion, that's the question of morals, that's the question of economics, that's the question of politics, culture.
I think in order for this to become a revolution, it kind of needs to be industry driven. The problem with it being industry driven is, I think unless industry drives this, we're gonna be hitting walls. The biggest ego out there is within industry. I think individually, you and I, we have egos, but we can overcome them. But you reach a certain level of management in an organization that's driven by greed and margins and improving asset turnover rate and pumping up ROI and increasing stock value, and everything revolves around shareholder value. We got some things to overcome before the part of the world that I think could actually turn this into a revolution actually does so. I think if we leave it to us in government policy and what you talked about, it's never gonna gain the momentum that it could if industry would just stand behind this. And I told you about I think you just walked in, I had a meeting with Fortune 500 companies where they're just not interested in this because it doesn't have anything to do with doing things better, faster, and cheaper. So when I say I want it all, give me greener where you don't have to mitigate against the things that companies seem to value more. And I realize there's a paradox there. Yeah.
The movement, the public benefit corporation movement has started. Michigan has resisted, even though it was introduced into legislation in 2010. But it was started in Philadelphia by people that are in the localist movement, the Ballot, the Business Alliance for Local Living County. Mm-hmm. And they're all about business that wants to do better and the triple bottom line, which is people, earth, and profits.
Right.
You can make profits and still do well with people and the planet.
Yep.
So the question is awareness. I mean, the movement has started. Fortune 500, corporatism, that their ideology is the problem.
Yep.
So if you're talking to that audience, mm-hmm. and you don't have the people from the public benefit corporation and alternative ownership models behind you, you're not going to win. When I fought fracking in New York, and New York just passed a law banning fracking, so they won out over Exxon and Mobil. And the way they did it, the legislature told the people that went to Albany, if you want to win the battle, you better get 50% of the people here in Albany in the courthouse. The people will change the system. They will insist that it goes from eco to ego.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, ego to eco.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't have 50%, the politicians are going to take the path of least resistance, which is to